Hello, and welcome to Racial Discrimination in the Jim Crow Era. My name is Jim Dumas. I'm the Deputy Executive Director at the National Archives Foundation. The National Archives Foundation is the nonprofit partner of the National Archives. For over 30 years, the Archives Foundation has supported the educational offerings, the civic educational component of the National Archives, and tried to offer these all around the country. We're very proud of the work that we do, and we see what we call a crisis in civic education. The idea that folks are pulling away from our basic institutions, are not participating in the republic that's designed for them to participate in, to make their voices heard. We see educators like yourself as a critical component in changing this and making a sea change that would be for the benefit of all of us in our nation. And we have a wonderful workshop ahead of you. This is the third of a three-part series. We're excited to have Charles Flanagan back again. Charlie is the at the Center for Legislative Archives. This is the division of the archives that holds all of the holdings from the U.S. Congress and the U.S. Senate. He has been at the center since 2009. And one of the things about Charlie that I think is the most important part is that he was a high school and a middle school teacher for over 30 years. He understands the pressures that are placed on educators. And we hope that these workshops are one step in a conversation we'll have with you for a long period of time in ways of supporting the important work you do. So with that, I'm going to pivot to Charlie and start the workshop. Charlie, are you there?
I'm here. Thank you, Jim, and good morning, everybody, and welcome to our webinar. Today, we're going to talk about racial discrimination in the Jim Crow era. I'm going to share a PowerPoint with you so that we can all follow along the same material. And I'm going to open the chat box. So as we have in the other workshops, we can continue our conversation about this topic as we go along. So again, at any time, if you have questions or comments, please feel free to just put them in the chat box so we all can share and respond to your ideas. But the question for today's webinar is, how did Jim Crow laws and practices limit the freedom of Black Americans? And we're going to study the time period from the Reconstruction era down until the 1960s and the debate about the Voting Rights Act. And we're gonna show primary sources from several lessons that can help you bring this topic into your classroom. But let's start first with a quote that'll frame our conversation. This is a quote from Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King when he spoke during the March on Washington in 1963. He said, "Five score years ago, a great American, in whose symbolic shadow we stand today, signed the Emancipation Proclamation. But 100 years later, the Negro is still not free. 100 years later, the life of the Negro is still sadly crippled by the manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today." And that's an excerpt from his speech, which we know as the I Have a Dream speech, but it really frames the question of the equality of all Americans. So we have five lessons on the problem of racial inequality. And you know, when you're teaching American history, race is one of the central and inescapable issues and questions that you have to teach about. And so we thought that these lessons would help you unpack different aspects of this topic. So the first lesson that you see on the screen there is reviewing the Civil War and Reconstruction. And the second was Reconstruction, a Revolution. The third, discussing equality. The fourth, where we'll spend most of our time today, the impact of racial discrimination on the lives of Black Americans in the Jim Crow era. And then lastly, Congress protects the right to vote. So as we go through this presentation, I'll draw a couple of documents from each of these lessons. But again, the lion's share of what we focus on will be the lesson with the red star just to the left of its title. So the first lesson we're going to look at is this one, reviewing the Civil War and Reconstruction. And in this lesson, students study analyze the analyze primary sources to review major issues related to the Civil War and Reconstruction. We created this lesson for teachers who start the course with the Civil War and Reconstruction, essentially teaching the second half of US history. And you'll see that it's to create a grounding for the kids as they launch into that program. Well, one of the documents from this lesson is the decision in the Dred Scott versus Sanford case. And this 1857 decision by the Supreme Court really crystallized the federal government's opinion about race. It really crystallized the status of African Americans on the eve of the Civil War, because in 1857, Chief Justice Roger Taney said, "The question in this case is simply this. Can a Negro whose ancestors were imported into this country and sold as slaves become a member of the political community formed and brought into existence by the Constitution of the United States, and as such, become entitled to all the rights and privileges and immunities guaranteed to the citizen? We think that they are not, and that they are not included and were not intended to be included under the word citizens in the Constitution." So essentially what the court ruled in that court case is that people of African ancestry were not citizens of the United States, were not intended to be citizens of the United States, and more importantly, could not go to court to protect their rights. And so that's a very dire and stark statement. Now, one of the really powerful changes in American history occurred over the course of the next 11 years, because with the Civil War, and the enactment of the post-Civil War constitutional amendments, specifically the 13th Amendment that ended slavery, the 14th Amendment that defined citizenship, and the 15th Amendment that created a bar against racial discrimination in voting, we have a whole new foundation of America. You could argue that the Reconstruction era was a second founding of America. In the first chapter of American life under the Republic and the Constitution, you had a slave republic where people were fundamentally not equal. And with the ratification of the three amendments in the 1860s, you're in a whole different republic. You're in a different country where the federal government has greatly enhanced powers over civil rights and all people are equal. And the equality of American citizens was in a powerful and novel way expressed in the 14th Amendment. And I have section one of that amendment on the screen right now. And it says that all persons born or naturalized in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction thereof are citizens of the United States and of the state wherein they reside. No state shall make or enforce any law which shall abridge the privileges or immunities of citizens of the United States, nor shall any state deprive any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor deny to any person within its jurisdiction the equal protection of the laws. So you see, this is a point by point refutation of the Dred Scott decision. So if the court in 1857 interpreted the Constitution as it was at that moment, this is a fundamental reordering of the Constitution. So the Dred Scott decision is no longer relevant. Now, all citizens are equal. No state can deny the privileges and immunities of citizenship to anyone. Well, a constitutional amendment is a statement of principle. But in order to have any power, it needs to be backed up with legislation. And so in our lesson, was Reconstruction a revolution? We asked the question about whether the changes brought about by constitutional amendments and legislation in this Reconstruction period fundamentally changed American society or not. And as you know, it's a moot question, which is what gives it its power. So we thought that having students investigate this question was a good way to orient them to studying the history of the United States from 1865 to today. And so if we look at a couple of documents from this lesson, you'll get a sense of the power behind this question. So the first is on the screen right now. This is a piece of legislation that was introduced by Senator Charles Sumner in 1873. It was passed by the Congress 2 years later, and it's called the Civil Rights Act of 1875. But we're going to study it today in the form in which it was first introduced. And so on the screen, you see two versions. You see a small version and then a blow up of an excerpt. So over on the left, you see the bill itself, the first page of it. And you can see that it was S1, the first bill that the Senate took up in that session, a priority piece of legislation. And you remember Senator Sumner because he was famously caned by Preston Brooks as he sat at his desk in the Senate in 1857. So what I would like to do is have you take a look at what's underlined in this excerpt from that legislation. And notice what it says, that no citizen of the United States shall by reason of race, color, or previous condition of servitude be accepted or excluded from the full and equal enjoyment of any accommodation, advantage, facility, or privilege furnished by, then there's a list, innkeepers, common carriers, whether on land or water, licensed owners, managers, or lessees of theaters or other places of public amusement, by trustees, commissioners, superintendent, teachers, or other officers of common schools and public institutions of learning, and so on. What I'd like you to do is tell me in the chat box, would this piece of legislation make a revolutionary change in American society if it were enacted as written? Does this language that you see underlined have the potential in 1873 to fundamentally change America? And please respond in the chat box if you would. Oh, thank you for breaking the ice. I always wonder if the chat box is working. There we go. Yes, absolutely. Evolution or revolution? Interesting question. And, you know, so the first activity in this lesson is to have the students define what a revolution is, because it really depends on how you define it. We often think of a revolution as a radical break with what came before. And so, you know, you have different types of revolution, like the agricultural revolution, the industrial revolution, and those are different in nature. The French Revolution is different in nature from the American Revolution, for example. So getting the kids to define more precisely what a revolution is the first step. And then they can ask whether each of these documents is revolutionary. And each one is revolutionary to some extent, but it depends on how you define it. And so anyway, that's what you know, you want the kids to do, is learn how to be critical thinkers. And, you know, as Gabrielle says, I think the term full and equal enjoyment is important to note. And I think that's right, because, you know, we're not just being legalistic. We're talking about enjoyment in the sense that we had in the Declaration of Independence, that you have a right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And so, you know, it seems like this would be a revolutionary change if people would live up to it. The question is whether legislation can change the hearts and minds of people. And so I have a document now that we're going to juxtapose against this one, which is going to show us a response. This was a petition sent into Congress while the Sumner bill was being debated. So it's from the president and directors of the St. Louis Public Schools. And it's specifically a petition against the school integration clause of the Civil Rights Bill. So part of the Sumner Bill, you know, as you heard when I just read it to you, said that you cannot discriminate in theaters, common carriers, you know, stage coaches, and in places of learning. So these folks are writing in and saying, whoa, not so fast. We don't want you to integrate the schools. And I'm going to zoom in on their letter and let you look at their reasoning. They say two things, and I took an excerpt from their document up on the top of the screen, and then I made a transcript at the bottom. So kindly read the bottom and answer. There's a question down there: were racial attitudes changed by the Civil War and the 14th Amendment? What do you think in light of these two excerpts from the document by the St. Louis School Board? They have not changed. In fact, you can see a couple of principles that we're going to talk about later that are embodied in these two statements. It's basically Plessy, 20 years before Plessy. It sure is, because they're saying, hey, we provided separate schools that are just as good as the ones for white people. So why can't those colored people, they call them, go to those separate schools? And, the other thing, the bottom one is really interesting, because opening school admissions to children of both races would cause the withdrawal of large numbers of white children, as it happened later in the 1950s, and white flight. And, today you could argue that schools are not fully integrated because they're often local to zip codes. And as people move to different zip codes, you have, in effect, a separation of children. And so, in the 1870s, they're saying, hey, if you do this, we'll have white flight. So were huts and barns changed by the Sumner legislation? Well, potentially, but maybe not actually. So in that lesson, was Reconstruction a revolution? You can explore those questions. Okay, well, let's go up now to 1877 with the compromise that ended Reconstruction. The question is, going forward, would racial distinctions separate Americans? And I'll show you a couple of pieces of legislation and a court case that are going to show how the federal government backed away from its commitment to equality. And the first, well, these are in the lesson, by the way, discussing equality, who is included within the phrase, we the people. And this lesson looks at documents from different time periods, and it asks the students to think about whether the documents show people being included within the phrase we the people or not. And the first document is this piece of legislation, which was enacted in 1882, and it's called the Chinese Exclusion Act. Now, in order to really get it, what the students would have to know is that there were a lot of Chinese in America, that a great number, more than 100,000 Chinese worked on the Transcontinental Railroad, for example. They were a major immigrant group to California in the 1850s. So here we are 30 years later, like a generation later, and this piece of legislation says, whereas in the opinion of the government of the United States, the coming of Chinese laborers to this country endangers the good order of certain localities within the territory thereof. Therefore, and it says, be it enacted, and then so on. At the end of that clause, it says, it shall not be lawful for any Chinese laborer to come, or having so come after the expiration of the said 90 days, to remain within the United States. Do you see anything racist about this piece of legislation? Because if you notice, prior immigration legislation said people of good character or people who've committed certain crimes can't come into the U.S. But here, if you are Chinese, if you are of that ethnic group, you cannot come to the United States or stay here, because if you are of that ethnic group, you would endanger the good order of certain localities. So it's kind of like Dred Scott. Yes, signaling out one ethnicity or nationality, regardless of personal history, race-based policy. That's right. So we're backing away from the 14th Amendment only a few years after it was enacted. It was enacted in 1868, and here we are only 14 years later, and we're backing away from it to ban people of Chinese ancestry. Well, then we had the Plessy case, which was mentioned earlier, and that was in 1896. And in that one, a man named Homer Plessy, who was partly African ancestry, partly European, one grandparent was of African ancestry. And so he looked like a white person, essentially. And he rides on a car that was reserved for white people, but he tells the conductor that he is of mixed race. And the conductor physically throws him off the train because of a law they had in Louisiana that said, you know, whites and blacks can't be on the same train car. And so he goes to court and sues, and the court decides, as you see below the excerpt from the case at the bottom of the screen, we cannot say that a law which authorizes or even requires the separation of the two races in public conveyances is unreasonable. The reasonable thing is to separate people by race. And so again, as one of you just commented, as Laurie just commented, it's a race-based policy from the Supreme Court. So we're in an era where the federal government, through its major institutions, is distinguishing by race, and it is distinguishing people according to race. And in that country, with the 14th Amendment, still, it really matters whether you are white or black. So we're going to push our argument forward by talking about teaching with visual primary sources, and we're going to look at two of them that are going to give us the context of what the Jim Crow era was like. When we talk about the Jim Crow era, we are talking about the time period when the federal government did not enforce civil rights protections. So we're talking about the time period from 1877 until, take your pick, it could either be 1957 with the first civil rights legislation or 1964 with the first powerful civil rights legislation. But the Jim Crow era is that time period between 1877 and we'll say 1957, when there is no federal protection of civil rights. So we could look at textual primary sources and we could hear the voices of Americans in that time period, and we will. But we could also look at visual primary sources to see the actions of people. And I have two visual primary sources. One, the people from yesterday will be familiar with, and it is this map. Okay, now look at the map in a slightly different way than we looked at it yesterday. Yesterday, we looked at it in terms of women and using statistical data to support a political argument. Today, I want you to look at it more generally. What does this map say to us about racial discrimination in the Jim Crow era? What's the message you would get from this map if you were an African American looking at it in 1922? And please answer in the chat box your thoughts on those general questions. And again, as you're thinking about it, I'll just remind you that the numbers in red indicate the number of lynchings that occurred in various states during a 30-year period. And some of the numbers are astounding. Yeah, the violence in the South is a very dangerous place to be. Probably about 80% of the African Americans in America lived in those Southern states at this time period. You would think you're glad you don't live in the South. Yeah, and if you think about the purpose of lynching, the impact on Black lives of that terror campaign would be profound. If you got out of your place, you would be killed, or you could be killed, I should say. It would tell me where not to travel. Yeah, and if you're familiar with the movie Green Book or the Green Book itself, it was a guide created by African Americans in the 20th century to advise them where they could safely go in various places in the South, because there were some places that were just inherently dangerous and there were other places that were a little bit safer. But you can see the work of individuals and communities to suppress the equality of African Americans reflected in these numbers. And, you know, there's some comments on this map that I think make it a good teaching tool. This was at a time period of the 1920s of drives to unionize American workers and get better working conditions for industrial workers. And it says, mob violence and lynching, the only industries the South votes solidly to protect. And the other thing that it alludes to is the idea of a protective tariff. And, you know, you had the Hawley Smoot tariff of the late 1920s, the Fordney-McCumber tariff of the early 1920s. And so, you know, you had this idea of protecting industries from foreign competition. Well, here we have the only industries the South wants to protect are mob violence and lynching. So you have allusions to that. Does anyone know when the first anti-lynching legislation was passed by the US Congress? It was introduced a lot of times in the 20th century. When was the first time that a successful bill was passed to make lynching a federal crime? Can anybody tell me? It's sort of like Final Jeopardy, if you know this, but it's just a surprising fact. And the answer is 2019 with the Emmett Till Act. And so it's very recent. Yeah, just like last year, 2019, 2 years ago. And so until that time, there was not a law that made lynching a federal crime. So if you lynch somebody, it's like Emmett Till was lynched in the 1950s, his killers were tried in local court with a local jury. If you'd had a federal anti-lynching law passed, they would have been tried in a federal court with a much more likely outcome being a guilty verdict. Okay, here's my second visual document to frame the Jim Crow era. What would this picture say to you if you were an African-American in the 1920s? What do you see and what would it convey to you? Look at it through the eyes of a 1920s African-American. KKK fear, loud, proud white supremacist. Yeah, does anybody recognize where this parade took place? DC, again, it says on the left, but you see the Capitol in the background, marching down DC. When we talk about the Ku Klux Klan, we often talk about them wearing hoods to conceal their identity, men on horses wearing hoods. This is the second Ku Klux Klan, which was inspired by the movie Birth of a Nation in 1914. And it was more active in more northern states from the Deep South. So here we have them in Washington, D.C. What do you notice about the participants in this parade? A lot of women. And apparently the government must be okay with white supremacy, one of you says, because here they are with the flag and the Capitol, both in their picture. Female. Yeah, and they're not trying to hide their identities, if you notice. They seem to be quite proud. Loud and proud white supremacist was a comment that we had earlier. And so, you know, if you're thinking about the Jim Crow era, there's no federal protection of civil rights, and there are public displays like this where the Ku Klux Klan is associating itself with symbols of power and authority. You see the cross, you see the flag, you see the Capitol in the background. And the other thing you can see are all the people along the sidewalk watching. What does that suggest? Yeah, support, agreement, popularity, right? All those things. So, you know, the question then is like, so what would it be like to live in Jim Crow America if you were an African-American? And so we made up a lesson called The Impact of Racial Discrimination on Black American Lives in the Jim Crow Era. And we studied the years from 1944 to 1960 in the documents that we chose. And we're gonna look at a few of these documents together and talk about them. So we're gonna start with the topic of segregation in the armed forces during World War II. And just to give you some context, about 1 million African-Americans joined the US armed forces and fought in World War II. About half of them served overseas, and thousands of them served in combat. And you've heard of the Tuskegee Airmen, for example. But the most common assignments for Black servicemen were menial and supply roles. So they fought, they served. And what was that like? Well, we have a letter to indicate one man's experience. This is from a soldier serving in Italy in 1940. 44. And he says, all my life, I've been hustling nickels and dimes to contribute to the Red Cross. Ever since I can remember, in school and in church, I've scuffled to belong to various Red Cross enterprises. And he's writing to his wife, and he says, you're forever telling me about working for the USO, contributing to the Red Cross. I don't believe that anything you could do would make me any more angry than to hear of you giving another penny or spending another minute at a USO club. So this excerpt from the top of his letter begs the question of what's wrong? What's his beef? What's he complaining about? And so on the next slide, I've got the rest of the story. And so the Frenchmen, whom the American Red Cross, the Italians, who before they were conquered were allies of the Germans and who have been responsible for the taking of thousands of American lives, these soldiers, providing they are wearing the American uniform, have access to all the facilities of the American Red Cross. So the people we're fighting against can go to the USO or participate in Red Cross activities. But this same organization to whose benefits the Negro has contributed stands solidly on its feet and bluntly tells the American-born Negro soldier that, quote, we have a regulation that does not include Negroes in our program. And he concludes, I have found that one of the most insufferable fates that can happen is to be born an American Negro. And so you get the idea that the thanks that Black soldiers got for their service was discrimination. And so this takes us inside the American Army during the Jim Crow era. So what we'll do, and as we look at these documents, I invite you just to go ahead and comment in the chat box. We won't stop at all of them for explicit questions, but you know, feel free. If you think there's something teachable in one of the documents, if you think you could use it in your classroom, go ahead and say that in the chat box because it's helpful to hear that. So this is one of the documents from the lesson. And of course, the next document in the lesson is the executive order by which President Harry Truman desegregated the armed forces. And this kind of gives you a sense of why that executive decision by President Truman was so powerful on its impact on the military, but also its impact on American life. So let's look at another aspect. Segregation in public recreation facilities in post-war America. And you could complement this by looking at segregation in suburbia in the same time period, but we'll look at the swimming pool example. Now, one of the things that we wanted to get at with this is the idea kids have that, yeah, there was slavery and that was very bad. And then there was the Jim Crow era, you know, way back, and it was really bad, but things got better. That stuff, that was all a long time ago. Things have gotten a whole lot better since. Well, maybe not so, because swimming pools were a new idea in the, you know, mid-20th century. And so I have a quote here from a Marketplace radio report that said, cities began to racially segregate pools throughout the North, and then it extended all throughout the United States. And Black Americans were typically relegated, if a pool was provided at all, to a small indoor pool that wasn't nearly as appealing as the large outdoor resort pools that were provided for whites. So separate, unequal, and as this new facility becomes available, segregation is expanded to incorporate it. So segregation is growing and getting worse over time, not diminishing and going away. We have a newspaper article that underscores this. This is from 1950 from a Washington, D.C. newspaper. And the headline is that six pools are to be opened on a non-segregated basis this spring. Now, when you read that, it just sounds factual. Okay, six pools to be opened on non-segregation basis. But you have to ask yourself, what made that newsworthy? And it's newsworthy that you're going to have non-segregated pools, which indicates that the public pressure was for the opposite. And in the article, a paragraph that I extracted mentions the Secretary of Interior, Oscar Littleton Chapman. And it says, Mr. Chapman said he hopes and believes that there would be no repetition of the racial troubles this year. He said he is most anxious to avoid any comment at this time that would aggravate the issue. And so what you can see is that there's white pressure to segregate. And if blacks try to use the pool that whites use, then there's going to be trouble. And if you looked at Isabella Wilkerson's book, Caste, she speaks about this issue in some very powerful ways. Well, I wanted to introduce this news article because the document we have in the lesson is from former First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt. And she's writing to President Harry Truman, and she's talking about this swimming pool issue. And she says, "Dear Mr. President, Mr. Joseph D. Lohman of the National Committee on Segregation in the nation's capital has just written me of the success they've had in St. Louis in keeping their swimming pools unsegregated." And I'm going to just stop and say, so again, you see that the public pressure is to segregate, and the liberal activists are pushing back to keep the pools unsegregated. He tells me that the courageous attitude shown by the administration in supporting democratic principles in the Washington situation has helped the situation all over the country. You and Secretary Chapman have shown great courage in bringing this about. It is these step-by-step achievements which will in the end bring us real equal rights in our own nation. So swimming pools are a small thing, but swimming pools are a metaphor for the larger racial relationship of Americans with one another. And so, you know, in a country that has the 14th Amendment, it's important that small steps like integrating swimming pools can lead to a better society. But it's also a picture of a divided society when you look at a letter like this, because you have to make such an effort to resist the expansion of segregation. So from swimming pools, we'll go to public schools. Segregation in public schools. And this is the complaint from the famous series of five cases, which were grouped together under the title Brown versus Board of Education. And this is the NAACP's complaint in that case. And so they're saying a couple of things that are relevant to where we've been. We started talking about the 14th Amendment. Notice the first point they make is the equal protection clauses of the 14th Amendment to the Constitution of the United States forbids the racial separation herein practiced. The mere unjustified fact of segregation in education is unconstitutional. And so the idea that separate is unequal is at the core of the Brown decision. And when the court issues its ruling in 1954, you could argue that it opens the door to a different America if people would comply with the ruling. But you know, there was a lot of resistance to the Brown ruling. And we have in the lesson an example of a letter from a Southern governor, James Burns of South Carolina. So before we get to his letter, let's frame it with a news story. This is from the Washington Evening Star in 1952. At the time, it was announced that the Supreme Court had agreed to take on the Brown decision. And in that letter, you know, they talk about how the court's going to hear the case, but down a few paragraphs below where the excerpt is, I pulled up a paragraph or two and I blew them up over to the right so you could read them. Governor James F. Burns of South Carolina has said that if his state loses its fight in the courts to maintain segregation, the public school systems there will be abandoned. Other southern states, notably Georgia, Virginia, and Alabama, have taken steps which could lead to the abolition of the public school systems in favor of privately operated classrooms. If we have to integrate the schools, we'll close them. So it echoes the St. Louis document, but even more powerfully. And here is just a scan of Governor Burns' overall letter. And then if we look more closely, the arguments that he's making, I've excerpted at the bottom of this slide. He says, basically, there are five cases pending, and the court may conclude that making a racial distinction in Kansas schools is unreasonable. But the court cannot say that South Carolina's segregation is unreasonable because there are 10 colored students for every white student. So I'll let you mull that one over and think about what Governor Burns is saying. It's okay to have integrated schools if you don't have a lot of African Americans, but where you have a black majority, then the schools must be segregated. And the use of the word reasonable echoes the Plessy Ferguson case, because they said, you know, it's reasonable to segregate. So the question with the Brown case is, would people go along with it? And this cartoon by Jim Berryman, which is from a book, an ebook that we have called A Visual History. And it's a free ebook that you can download, and it covers American history with political cartoons from 1940 to 1963, different aspects of life, foreign policy, civil rights, and so on. Well, a year after the federal troops enforced the Brown decision by desegregating schools in Little Rock, Arkansas went to court seeking a 2.5-year delay of enforcing the Brown decision. And Berryman drew this cartoon at the time. So you can see a roadblock on the path to integrated schools would be the 2.5-year suspension order. And while they didn't get that specific order successfully, it just is indicative of a pattern of massive resistance across the South to the idea of integration in public schools. So what's it like to be a Black in America in the 1950s? Well, you can't go in the swimming pool. You can't go to the same school as white children. But there's more. What about segregation in public transportation? And we have here the arrest record fingerprints of Rosa Parks. And so if you think about it, you know, what's the message? This is pretty illustrative of the risk that you take as an African-American if you don't comply with the segregationist policies of your community. Because in Montgomery, Alabama, they had a local ordinance that said Black people have to move to the back of the bus when white people wish to sit in the seats up front. And Ms. Parks refused to comply with that. And so she was arrested. And so she's criminalized by merely riding on a bus and not going along with the segregationist practices. So it gives you a sense of the climate in which people live their lives. Now, you could think, well, Congress fixed all this by legislation, but it didn't quickly, and it didn't effectively until later. From 1877 to 1957, there was no progress on civil rights in Congress. The first civil rights legislation to be proposed after Reconstruction was done in 1957. And one of the central issues in that was the question of voting discrimination. And we have an excerpt here from testimony from Attorney General Herbert Brownell. And I'm just going to show you quickly a little bit of what they said, that we're in his, it's like a middle page of a long, like 17 or so page document, but he talks about challenges to Black voters and the swearing of affidavits to challenge the voter registration, the validity of the voter registration of African-American voters in Ouachita County, Louisiana, for example. And so if you look where it's underlined in red, it says, such affidavits were filed challenging every one of the 2,389 Negro voters in Ward 10. None of the 4,054 white voters in that ward were challenged. And so you get the idea that it's discriminatory in the sense that we're going to say that Black voters are fraudulently registered, but not white voters. And so if you read that document, you can see, you know, who says that these people are even qualified to judge these voting credentials. And so he pointed that out as one of the many injustices that needed to be addressed by civil rights legislation. And so at the time that the bill to address some of those injustices, the Civil Rights Act of 1957, was introduced in the Senate, Jim Berryman drew this cartoon. And I wanted to show it to you because it dramatizes how in Congress you had a roadblock to progress on civil rights because power was based on seniority and the one party South was home to the most powerful committee chairs. And so these Southern committee chairs used their power to block civil rights bills. And if they couldn't kill them in committee, then they had the Senate filibuster. And so they could delay it and delay it and delay it and eventually kill it that way. So here we have a cartoon published as the civil rights bill goes into the Senate in 1957. And I think it's a very daunting but informative primary source. And so what I want to recommend is that when you use this with the kids, in order for them to interpret it, you might have them do this. You might have them divide it into three panes, or you might cut it into three parts for them. And if you want to think about how Congress played a role in not passing civil rights, you have the past action where committees have the power to stop a bill. And you can see in this case, the civil rights bill has made it around the Judiciary Committee. Okay, but now notice how its passage through the Senate is really risky. It's like it's running across a river on ice. And that's a literary allusion, which to Uncle Tom's Cabin. But anyway, running across the river. But what's waiting for it on the other shore is not passage, but the filibuster. So if you have the kids think about this, you can teach them to decode really challenging primary sources by doing things like this strategy of cutting it up and thinking about it in terms of, okay, what does it show? Is there a sequence of actions here? Can I divide them? I want to move from legislation to the idea of attitudes, diversity and American attitudes. And we have two documents that I'm going to get you to talk about. Here's the first one, Ku Klux Klan violence. And it's a letter from a man named Byron De La Beckwith. And he wrote it to President Eisenhower on the stationery of the Mississippi Society of the Sons of the American Revolution. Now, his handwriting is hard to read, so I made a transcript. But I want to show you before we get to the contents of the letter, how the stationery is illustrated. Because as a primary source, you want the kids to look at all aspects, you know, of the document. So these are the things that he has on his stationery. And so if you look, you see on the largest image, remember Little Rock, and you have a soldier with a bayonet on a rifle marching, a black kid and a white kid to school. And then you have join the Citizens Council for states' rights, racial integrity, and constitutional government. And then it says the Mississippi Society of the Sons of the American Revolution. Okay, so what does Beckwith say in his letter? Dear President Eisenhower, I wish to praise you in your speech last night, telling the Chinese to negotiate or fight. Now then, to another subject. This summer, we were host to the National Society SAR, Sons of the American Revolution. Every SAR who came to Mississippi saw, participated in, and approved of our way of segregation. 98% of the SAR are infuriated over forced integration and are doing something to stop forced integration. Nearly every one of us, except you. Do you still choose to be and act like an SAR? We wish you would get hold of yourself and again, order segregation. This seems unlikely. Therefore, it appears to us that you would rather see white and Negro bodies piled high in the streets so their blood will mingle freely in the gutters. This is the only way our blood will mix. This is the last that you shall hear from me insofar as me begging and pleading for you to restore states' rights, racial integrity, and constitutional government to the land. It's evident that you neither desire this for the people nor wish for them to obtain it. Nevertheless, we shall have it, whether you wish for it or not. Many will suffer now, but soon all will be better for the South and the nation. It's my purpose to make life happy for most of us by thwarting some of them who would destroy all of us. Okay, so what access does this give you to the 1950s and the mind of an extremist in that decade? Anything you would like to say in the chat box about this one? The hate is incredible. Yeah, it's horrific. This is domestic white terrorism, basically. And this man, Byron De Beckwith, 5 years later, will murder civil rights leader Medgar Evers. And so this is a guy who has a track record of promoting violence. Yeah. And then he will act on that impulse later. And so he's kind of a famous figure. And so we're going to leave his letter. And well, sounds sadly similar to ideas we're hearing most recently. Yeah, well, racism isn't gone. And so it's important for kids to understand, you know, in American history, this has been a persistent issue. So his letter, you know, is pretty powerful. I want to show you a contrasting letter. And this one is from the baseball great Jackie Robinson, written to President Eisenhower in 1958. And it's also critical of President Eisenhower. But I want you to notice that the format is different. First, you see it's on the letterhead of the company where Jackie Robinson was a vice president after his baseball career, Chock Full of Nuts Coffee Company. And then we're going to look at what he says and notice that the tone is different. And yet he has been critical. And he says, I was sitting in the audience at the summit meeting of Negro leaders yesterday when you said we must have patience. On hearing this, I felt like standing up and saying, oh no, not again. I respectfully remind you, sir, that we have been the most patient of all people. When you said we must have self-respect, I wondered how we could have self-respect and remain patient considering the treatment accorded us throughout the years. 17 million Negroes cannot do as you suggest and wait for the hearts of men to change. We want to enjoy now the rights that we feel we are entitled to as Americans. This we cannot do unless we pursue aggressively goals which all other Americans achieved over 150 years ago. So Martin Luther King said he could not have done what he did unless Jackie Robinson came before him. And so you get a voice from the 1950s, before really the famous part of the civil rights era, expressing the fact that, you know, it's the attitude of white people that's really a problem here. You say we got to be patient. You say you have to wait. But what about the rights that were being denied? And, you know, it's I think, a powerful letter. And you could use that with the Beckwith letter kind of as a back and forth to teach all kinds of things about racial attitudes in that time period, but also rhetoric and the effectiveness of Jackie Robinson's persuasive message. Because our time is so short, I want to leap ahead to a lesson we have called Congress Protects the Right to Vote, the Voting Rights Act of 1965. In this lesson, we position the kids as if the evidence that the committee looked at as it debated this legislation. And the first is about voting rights. And it's an excerpt from General Nicholas Katzenbach about voting rights in 11 Alabama counties. And because our time is so limited, I'll just ask you to take a quick look at two columns. They have red circles around the word percent in each column. And what they show is the left-hand one shows the percentage of white people who are registered to vote. So for example, in Bullock County, very patriotic county apparently, because you can see that 110% of the white people are registered to vote. Yet the African-Americans only have 31% voter registration. In Choctaw County, it's 71% for whites, 4% for African-Americans. Go all the way down to the bottom. In Wilcox County, 100% of the whites are registered and 0% of the blacks. What would this document illustrate about the impact of Jim Crow practices on American lives? Want to answer that in the chat box? Yeah, they are successful in this. Look, you have like Wilcox County has 6,000 black residents, 2,000 white residents, but all the voters are white. And if you look at some of the other counties, there's a black majority, but a white minority rules because they keep the blacks from voting. And so it's a real kind of math in the classroom way to look at statistics. And if you can't vote, you can't affect change. And, you know, with the Voting Rights Act being in the news again, because of the Selby County case and the John Lewis Voting Rights Act, which was introduced yesterday in the House, you know, this is relevant to today. So you could look at that, these statistics from the 1960s and get the kids to really focus on the discriminatory practices that resulted from the Jim Crow laws and ways of life. I'll also point out while we're looking at this document, this was, you know, the proposal for civil rights, voting rights legislation in 1965 was spurred by the march at Selma. And so this document was introduced 11 days after the violence at the Edmund Pettus Bridge. Okay, Dallas County, the third county on the list over on the left-hand column there, that's the county in which Selma is located. And so if you go across, you can see there were 9,000 whites in that county, 15,000 African-Americans. Only 2% of the African-Americans were registered. And so although there were almost twice as many African Americans as whites in Dallas County, all the decisions were made by the white voters. Blacks were effectively locked out of power by the practices that kept them from voting and kept them from registering to vote. So, I mean, it adds a poignancy of real clear statistics to your teaching of that time period. So, you know, maybe if you start with this document and then get the kids to study about the march at Selma, it will give them a sense of, you know, what was the big problem? Why were they marching? It wasn't just kind of an idealistic thing. It was also pragmatic. We can't affect change. We can't control our political lives if we cannot vote. I want to move on to my last document. This is excerpts from a speech. And this was a speech given by President Lyndon Johnson to a joint meeting of the House and the Senate on March 15th, 1965. Okay, so we talked about earlier how Congress was controlled and dominated by committee chairman, powerful committee chairman from the one party South. So Lyndon Johnson is from the South himself, but he's speaking to these people in the chamber. And he says, there is no Negro problem. There is no Southern problem or Northern problem. There is only an American problem. And we are met as Americans to solve it. This was the first nation in the history of the world to be founded with a purpose. The great phrases of that purpose still sound in every American heart, North and South. All men are created equal, government by consent of the governed, give me liberty or give me death. These words are a promise to every citizen that he shall share in the dignity of man. This dignity cannot be found in a man's possessions or his power or his positions. It rests on his right to be treated as a man, equal in opportunity to all others. It says that he shall share in freedom, choose his leaders, educate his children, provide for his family according to his ability and merits as a human being. And then President Johnson looks out at the leading Southern committee chairs and the audience in front of him, and he says, their cause must be our cause too, because it's not just Negroes, but really it's all of us who must overcome the crippling legacy of bigotry and injustice. And we shall overcome. So with those powerful ringing words from President Johnson, we have sort of a capstone to where we started with Martin Luther King, but connecting them is this question of how did the Jim Crow laws and practices limit the freedom of Black Americans? And so the lesson again is the impact of racial discrimination on Black American lives in the Jim Crow era. And I hope that the documents I've shared with you today give you some resources that you can use to bring into your classroom.